Welcome to Vision Plus.
I heard you speak at a special class where we normally have a dozen people, and that's 30 or 40. Mm-hmm. A bunch of people came in to hear you in this class that's normally real small, and that was good. And you told a little bit about your life, mm-hmm. and I wanted you to just share with everybody. It's so amazing.
Well, I started off with when I was younger, just loving the Lord from a young age and just interested in lost souls, mm-hmm. you know. And I noticed that when I was even younger watching a TV show, and then my interest grew as I went to college and, well, even in high school, setting up Bible studies and different things. And then as I was in college, you know, interest grew because when I did some work in Jemison, Alabama, that was my first spring break at college, and I was asked to go and door knock, mm-hmm. and I was paired up with another guy that was wonderful, Stinson Carpenter, and he taught me about how to just to talk to people and just listen and share the gospel and the good news, and it was just really a neat experience. And then that next summer, I was asked to go to a campaign in Scotland. And,
oh, that's so exciting. You know, I went to Baumholder, Germany, and got to do door knocking, mm-hmm. with the group. And I've already broken one of these glasses today. I think I'll try not to break this one.
Oh, but anytime you get to go out, mm-hmm. and I'm sure you're like me, maybe that you don't have a fear. I didn't have a fear of door knocking or meeting people. I love
really
meeting
didn't
people.
Either. I've yeah. done that a long time, too. And we used to teach the, before you were born, mm-hmm. Jules Miller's film strip. You mm-hmm. may have heard
of
it.
Oh, I have heard, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And we'd go, and it was so exciting to see the aha moment and the light come on, and then to find out that Jesus really did love them.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes. And so that's how I got started, just the reaching out to others that way, door knocking and meeting people. And then my experience even...
You weren't finished with college when you went
to
Scotland. How'd you get your parents to agree with that?
it wasn't too easy, really. My mom and dad wanted me to finish.
College, and before you went.
I had 2 years behind me, actually. Well, when I first went to Scotland, I had finished 1 year. And mm-hmm. so I really had an interest in the mission field and had heard about a program, Youth Outreach United Through Him, from Texas. It was established there. And so I started looking into it more and really had it on my heart to go back to Scotland. So I started introducing my idea to my parents and to other people. And
they said, are you nuts?
Now, at first, I think they did. And but my older sister and my brother-in-law were very supportive, and I think that helped my parents understand.
With them?
I guess as a teenager, visited a lot. I was almost like their first child, but we had a really great relationship. They just helped me grow in the Lord, and just I was able to open up and ask questions. And you know, just
now when you got over to Scotland, what about the culture shock? Or I know you said you had a culture shock when you came back to the United States, but what about when you were in?
Well, I didn't think as much. I missed home. I remember, and I didn't share this, but I remember looking up the stars when I'd be so homesick, and I think my parents and my family looked at the same stars that I did, mm-hmm. and it made the earth really small to me. And I remember those days because I would be lonely for just a hug from my mom, or you know, that kind of affection that mm-hmm. that you might not get because you've just gotten to know people, you know, for a short amount of time, and you needed just family loving, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I missed that a lot, but I remember I had a lot of comfort. And I remember, and I think I shared this in the class about getting on the plane, and that I remember it was, I said, God, it's just you and me. It's just you and me. And I remember the feeling that I had because I'd grown up in such a secure home and in safe environment. But now I was on my own, and I was, you know, ready to spread my wings, as people say. But just to branch out
what
and try
like
something
new. What was it like in Scotland?
You know, now there are different things as far as view. Like people I felt were a little bit more reserved and cold. Although, once you get to know them, very loving, you know. So it's very different weather, you know, because it is overcast most of the time. But beautiful land. I did miss a few trees. It didn't seem like we ever saw as many trees, but the rolling hills, the just beautiful. And the different cities we'd go visit, and we would help door knock. And I've meant to go back and look at all the different towns that we went to visit. Mm-hmm. Several, but... you know, Edinburgh was very common for us to go into Edinburgh and to Glasgow. But my main living, where I lived, was Livingston. Mm-hmm. And it was actually a newer community.
Were you with a family or in a hotel?
It was almost like an apartment. Mm-hmm. And I shared it. I was by myself for a few months. And then another girl from Florida arrived. And then a girl from Scotland joined our team. So there were three of us I stayed for almost a period of 2 years. And they came in, you know, like they were lived there at different times. And there were a group of two guys.
Did you meet a boy? Did a boyfriend?
Not really. I never found one.
Had you already met Kevin?
No. I had not. Uh-huh. I had not. And there were two guys that were on our team, and one was from England and one was from Scotland. And they were really some great guys that helped, you know, we just all studied together. And, you know, went.
But you didn't have that spark.
Yet. Nope, no spark.
No.
I don't know. I guess I was ready to come home to America, find me America. No. You know, find me a guy close to home. But, no, I didn't. We just were really busy.
Worked
hard.
It would happen? Were your parents afraid?
Yes, that was definitely one of the things. It was, Brian. You caught on to that. They were afraid that I would. I think I remember them saying that. I'm afraid you'll find somebody and want to marry and stay and be away from us. And actually, it really was different because now I live right beside my parents.
Oh boy!
So ventured out in the world and saw the world, I guess. But I came back home and finished my 2 years of college, and that's when I met Kevin at UNA, University of North Alabama. And
what's Kevin do?
He has a math degree and computer science. So I'm not sure. He does computer analyst. Basically, he works for Camber Corporation in Huntsville, and Camber, C-A-M-B-E-R.
Camber,
mm-hmm. And but really works as a in defense, you know, mm-hmm. defense contractor mm-hmm. now. So he's been working there since we married. Basically,
have you worked away from home since you and Kevin married?
Well, I did some teaching for a small amount of time, a short amount of time, and then we were ready to start a family. Mm-hmm. So I only did that. I had my teaching degree and in math, and taught for a little while and subbed some, and then I was pregnant with Ellen. So mm-hmm. I had always decided that I wanted to stay at home if at all possible. You know, that was one of my goals and dreams, is just to be able to stay at home, raise my children. Mm-hmm. And then I heard about homeschooling. That's how that came about when she was born, and it became very natural. I had that education background, but it was something that I had always, you know, that I had thought of after someone introduced it to me. And so I just started researching it, mm-hmm. and it became very natural.
What program do you work with?
Well, at the group of people. Uh-huh. Well, I've been with Way Home. The covering that we were under for mm-hmm. several years, and this year we just now went to Covenant Christian Academy, CCA, which has worked well for us because of we offer classes, sporting. You know, they can do sports and athletic program, and especially the classes have been great. Ellen, my oldest, is doing biology, and she has just love it and done really well.
She's up there studying right now.
She is very studious now. My boys had to motivate them a little more, but
but she just picked it up. I love. We had a speaker down in Birmingham, and he said that his daughter did really well. Was afraid even if she got a B. He said his two sons, if they made a B, it was time for a celebration because they really had a struggle with sticking to it, to study. They had the brains, they just didn't have the stick
motivation to it. Motivation is not, you know, for that. Now, they can be motivated in some other areas, but they, you know, other things. But now Ellen, she really wants to do well mm-hmm. and wants to, you know, just stay on top of things. And I don't have to tell her. She's very, you know.
Gets with it.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes. And the boys, I have to, you know, ask them over and over again, did you finish this? Did you finish this? So next year, my second child, Kenton, he's going to start his class, physical science, and he'll be a ninth grader, Ellen will be in 10th, and she'll do chemistry next year. And I'm also looking into enrolling him in some writing classes, because that's not my strength mm-hmm. either, but like for them to do, you know, a little more. And this year, Ellen actually did a science fair project, mm-hmm. and they really let you know up front, it's a family undertaking, yes, mm-hmm. Because it is, and, mm-hmm. and to teach and help your children do the best, and know all, you know, to write a research paper, and and there's so many things involved. So she got third place at CCA and then went to regionals and got third place in regionals. So she was really excited. But that was a big, you know, task, you know, and she was growing plants and doing some different things with that. And so that takes a lot of daily involvement.
Boy, it does.
It does.
And I know Dr. Nixon's son is, I believe he's an eighth grader. And
seventh
grader, and he's doing a project. He says it's not like science fair. It's a little bit different that he does. But he's like your Ellen. He's very motivated on his own because he was here. They were here till a few minutes ago, and he said, I got to get home because I got to work on my project. So she had to run him home real quick. But I was afraid you'd get here and you'd be here.
No, that's fine.
But that was good. You know, to see these young people, they have that self-motivation. Because there's really just three kinds of motivation. There's fear motivation, you're in your room or else.
Right.
And then incentive motivation, I'll give you $5.
And you have to do this.
Or that self-motivation that apparently Ellen has and Tristan has her son. So it's good to see that in a child.
Well, and certain things do, you know, they are more motivated, like say for the different reasons. My two boys, Jacob's my youngest, and they both were involved in robotics this year.
Her son was involved.
And I was wondering if anybody, you know, I've heard of that.
Yeah.
My oldest did it last year. See, just that was his first year, I think. And but this year, they both were able to be on the same team. And it's now, and that's also parents are you have to have some involvement in that too, because it's getting them places and just helping them with there's different. Different things that they have to do, not just make the robot perform, but they have a presentation, and so I was involved a lot in that. We made a little skit, and they did wonderful with that. And even the judges came out and said that was the best they'd seen all day, and they were so impressed how well the boys did. They had designed, it was really interesting because they had designed a Wii program or sort of established
like
that you could, like if you had knee surgery. When you come home, and my parents have even had this problem, not knowing how to do the exercise correctly.
Right.
And so they would be, it would be involved like with a Wii program where you could see what exercise you needed to do and follow it specifically. And then you'd have involvement with your doctor over like the computer. Mm-hmm. And the doctor would know how well you were doing your exercises.
So they
helped, you know, and I thought it was really great for them to branch out into, you know, the technology that we have today, use what they have today and to do, you know.
I want one of those Wii programs. But, and I would have done well. I had knee surgery, and I brought the diagrams home, but I was trying to remember. Now, how did they say do this?
Exactly. That's what the kid.
That's so good that they did that.
Well, they did a commercial.
I can see the need.
Yeah.
I needed it.
They did a commercial, and that's what they had different people, and one of them says something like that, you know, that, you know, I've got the sheet in front of me, but I can't understand the directions, you know. And they're very hard to follow to some degree. So it would be like a person on TV that would show you exactly what exercises to do.
Yeah, that's great.
So I think it's futuristic type, you know, technology. But I think it'd work, you know. So anyway, that's, I think, the joy behind homeschooling. I tell people all the time that I think I've learned more than they have. But by the third time, I should know my history or, you know, because it's funny. I think, oh, I forgot that. You know, but when I'm reading it with Jacob for the third time after the third child, I should know it. But that's the great thing about
it. It's easy to forget and to not be interested in. Mm-hmm. I know our granddaughter actually didn't do well in history. Mm-hmm. And when you said history, and so we took her to Washington, D.C. And said, here is a space in museum and the Holocaust Museum and the real, there really was Abraham Lincoln.
There really
was a Washington Monument.
Or it's just that visual that, you know, yes. It's
and she came back and then did straight A's after that. It was like, oh, history's real. And so that was such a good thing, I'm sure. Now, I wanted to ask you how you structure your day, and did the schools give you a hard time because they don't get as much money if you homeschool. So how did that go? Did they say?
Well, you don't hear a lot unless, this is my probably only complaint to some degree, is if we wanted to be involved in sports or band or theater type things from schools, we're not allowed to. And I've always felt like I mean, I personally chose to homeschool just because of spiritual reasons and wanted to spend time with my own children, you know. Mm-hmm. So, you know, not be, they would be gone for almost over 8 hours a day, and mm-hmm. I wanted to be to spend time with them. But, you know, the schools, some believe that, you know, we do it for just because we hate the schools, and it's not that. I know several families that do it because of they have allergies. The children have terrible allergies, and the school maybe has mold and mildew in some of the classrooms. So they choose to do it because of health reasons. And I really wish the schools sort of would open up to the opportunity for children to be involved in, you know, the band program that's local, to yeah. you know, locally for where they live. Because we live in New Hope, and so that, you know, affects us. And what if we wanted that choice? I think that hopefully in the future that homeschoolers will be able to maybe, like for me, math is my strength, to teach math and maybe some other subject and maybe go to school for a few hours, mm-hmm. you know. But we might want to be more involved than just sending them off for every subject. Mm-hmm. So we, and also if we go back to the structure of our day, it depends sometimes on how early we rise. We usually try to get up. Ellen's very good. She gets up about 7:15, 7:30. She's ready to go. The boys, it takes them a little longer to get going, especially my oldest son. And so I try to adjust a little bit to what each child, you know, how they can wake up and get started. Mm-hmm. But we usually get up, breakfast, do a few chores. Sometimes the boys, like, they go, I just need to get a shower and wake up, you know. Mm-hmm. I've even said for my youngest, get on the treadmill, get that blood going so we can get some, you know, get your brain awake. And so we get started probably about around 8:30 as far as schoolwork. Mm-hmm. And we just, sometimes I've had structure where we do certain subjects first, whether it be Bible or something. But a lot of times I let them choose. With Jacob, I do a lot more individual, one-on-one, attention with him. And Ellen and my other son, they're able to work alone a little more. Usually at the beginning of the week, we go over each subject, whether it's math, go over the lesson that they'll work on all week, and then help them as they go. Mm-hmm. So it varies depending on what we're doing. But because Ellen takes almost all her biology by herself. She might ask me a few questions, but she can go online if she has some questions or ask her dad. He's doing computer science, computer literacy with them this year because that's his, you know, his thing. So he can do that with them, but and they've really enjoyed that. But we just sort of do it, structure it, depending on what classes are taken. And like my son had a late back ball game last night, or tonight he's got a late one, and so he might get up a little later tomorrow, you know. Actually, today, tomorrow, we're doing a full field trip. We're going to Zip Stream. It's at Rock City. It is zip lines that you go from tree to tree. You have you're connected to a cable, and then you'll climb to another tree through different obstacle courses through trees. Oh my. And then it's in your zip line.
And that's at Chattanooga.
Chattanooga. Mm-hmm. So we've never done that. But my nephew's on his vacation. It's a spring break. And so we're going to go with him and my sister. So we're looking forward to that. So
where are you going for that?
That's Chattanooga.
Oh,
that's
okay.
The zip stream. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's really terrifying to me, right up the mountain on that. It seems like it's going straight up.
Oh, yeah. That, yeah.
Oh, my.
Well, we've never done this other, so we're looking forward to it.
Yeah, I've never heard of that.
Yeah, so it's really... Yeah,
really interesting.
It does.
And do you have to learn the trees also, I guess?
Or well, I just know that some are harder than others.
Yeah.
Some you're walking across maybe plank boards, mm-hmm. but you're connected. You're all latched up. You're not going to fall. I mean, I guess you wouldn't fall to the ground. But and some are just a cable. So I'm thinking I'm going to be the last one. Because my sister is, you know, she can make it fine. Yeah, she is. She rappels, and mm-hmm. they do all kinds of rock climbing and hiking and... So I think I'm going to be the one that's not in shape, to, you know.
Dragging up the rear.
Exactly. So anyway, we look forward to it, though.
Oh, that's good. Mm-hmm. Now, you said teach Bible, so you're coming back to your teaching mm-hmm. and your roots of mm-hmm. What all happened to you after going to Scotland, far as your own personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ? And what? Did you go to our women's retreat?
I did.
Okay, because this Ephesians, where it says our battle is not, I've read it, we read the Bible through every year, But it just seemed to hit me this mm-hmm. year. Our battle is not with flesh and blood, but with principalities and powers. And I was saying, gird about your loin or your waist with, truth.
That's true, yes.
Put on the breastplate of righteousness, their feet are shod with the gospel of peace, mm-hmm. and take up the shield of the faith and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. That's right before uh-huh. shield of faith and sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. But it just seemed like it came alive so much to me because I'd never read Ephesians slow before, you know, six verses at a mm-hmm. time. That was just like really interesting.
Yeah.
I loved it.
I know. And some of those, you know.
Because we read like five chapters a day and the prayer and the. All of that, and it's kind of rush. We gotta get to work.
Instead of really soaking it up and meditating on that, and so that's I think in the retreat it was wonderful.
Yeah, so many people there that I didn't remember mm-hmm. who all was there, but that was a good thing. Anyway, back to your what all happened to you in your personal relationship with the Lord.
Well, and you know, and it even started before Scotland, of just trying to. You know, then I had everything figured out, and this is what it was. It was just, you know, you obey it. Just here, just this is it. And I struggled with it, especially when you go overseas and you see everybody has different traditions to mm-hmm. some degree, and most people didn't want probably what our traditions or what we grew up, I guess. And that's where I started just questioning some things, and then I would question, you know, God's involvement in our life, you know, and you know, I said, did He just send us here, you know, with nothing, just self-determination to get to do right, you know. The more and more I studied, and I'm like, there are things in here that He's given us, the Holy Spirit, to guide us and mm-hmm. to give us strength and to help us through this life. Mm-hmm. And so I just started just studying more and more. And I mentioned that I had listened to Joyce Myers. We were, you know.
Yeah, I did too.
And I went to see her actually one time. My sister-in-law
did. I did too.
Yeah.
She
opened my eyes to a lot of things of how to live out Scripture.
Right. You know? And she shocks me sometimes with the things she says and the transparency. And it's helped me to be a little more transparent.
Oh.
And Dr. Nixon invited me to go to over and teach in the Philippines. And one thing about it in the Philippines, you may have found in Scotland, they are so open for you to talk about the Lord mm-hmm. right in the classroom. We had 115 students and then taught online on the way. But I mean, even every vehicle has I can do all things through Christ mm-hmm. who strengthens me. Jesus loves you. Even the Budweiser beer truck had God loves you, the 18-wheeler, God loves you and so do we. But it was so exciting to mm-hmm. see that other countries are so transparent, the Joyce Meyer type of attitude and the way the mm-hmm. Holy Spirit, I think, moves in our life to not keep so many secrets or so many, I'm afraid you won't like me if you know what about me. So,
well, that one, I know when I was in Scotland, that's what came out too. They were very open about sin in their life, you know, and it wasn't like let me tell. It was very humbling, you know.
Right.
They wanted you to know because they wanted to change. Uh-huh. So, and I thought that was an eye-opening experience because I think we still might say we have sin, but we won't really acknowledge it sometimes.
And we won't acknowledge what it is.
No.
I mean, excuse me.
And so, you know, getting back, like, even like the Holy Spirit, that was when I started, you know, thinking, how do I know how to handle a situation? You know, and where to, you know, to discern or know what to do in situations and to listen to the Holy Spirit. And I had to start thinking about, is He really wanting to call me in certain areas? And so that's when I had to just think, yes, from all the study that I had of the Scriptures, I thought, He wants to be involved in our life and give us direction. And there were several things that would come out in my life that, you know, would prove that He wants to be involved in our life. And, you know,
what would come out in your life?
Well, and that's what I was like shared like with Ellen, and she had terrible dreams.
Oh,
and
yes.
Remember me telling about that?
I
talked to her about it a little bit after I was, you know, going back over my life, and that one instance stood out because I could not help her. I remember she had such terrible dreams, and I remember praying on my own, Lord, just please, you know, take this away. And I guess I remember thinking my dreams were very just shallow, you know, just, I don't know, empty. And so
your dreams.
I mean, my prayers. I'm sorry. Okay. I said my dreams. My prayers were very empty, and I just couldn't help her. It was an area that I could not help her. You know how you think you can help your child or protect them or do whatever they need, you know, but I could not help her in this area. And so my sister-in-law, though, and I had been studying, and we talked about the Holy Spirit, and just at a place in our life where we're very open about that. And so she was determined. I mean, she came to our house, and she prayed for Ellen. And prayed. It was, we were in her room, and Ellen didn't have any more dreams like that. And I did say later on she had a dream, but it wasn't a nightmare. Right. All these others were nightmares almost. And so
after your sister-in-law prayed
in a powerful way, it was different.
Didn't you think of that earlier?
Well, you know, it was. We were at a place where we were trying to learn about trusting God in these areas. So.
I'm glad I picked that up because I turned that water over and it was on the book. I was just going to say, it sounds like you haven't had anything to happen to you. Like, Tony and I almost got a divorce. And so we got back together and wrote a book, Born Again Marriage, and how to cope with the D's in life, divorce, depression, death, drugs, drinking, and debt, and a lot of other D's. But I haven't heard you say anything that would indicate you had any troubles in your life.
Well, you know, I would say that, like, even like marriage, I tell people all the time, it is not easy. You know, it is a decision you make. Because even, I think everybody, if you go into marriage thinking it's going to be all, just because you love that person, it's going to be easy. It's not. Because I know we even had struggles really early on of because we were so different. Kevin's very quiet. And we married. Oh yes, he's very quiet, and I'm very outspoken. And good. Well, and I think you marry each other because you're so opposite. Yeah. But then you end up sometimes wanting to change each other. You know, you do. You want. You're like, why are you so quiet? Or and he's like thinking, why are you so outspoken? And I remember thinking, you know, I remember him talking. I was very upset. I said, this is the reason you married me. It's because I'm like this, and I'm married, and I'm stop trying to change you. You know, and we'll stop trying to change each other and appreciate what gifts we have. So I think, you know, and I think struggles, I remember college being very tough at times. It wasn't necessarily my own personal problems, but friendships and all the struggles that other people had to some degree. I don't know.
Like internalizing or
I just think I felt really, I had deep, it broke my heart when other people hurt like that. I think God made me tender to that. But personally, I didn't have some of the struggles others had. But my sister always saying, well, or somewhat, I think it started with her saying that some people want to please people. And from an early age, I wanted to please my parents, do the right thing. It came easy to me. But then also, I've really hurt when other people hurt. And but I think that I feel like life had been somewhat easy, but I don't know. I think part of that goes back to choices. You know, and
yeah, I made some really bad choices.
Well,
no doubt about
well, and I, you know, and I, I've learned from other people, and so I think that that's part of it. I think it, you know, I think that life has a lot to offer through Christ, but it's sometimes, you know, we struggle through our choices we make, and so
what I hear you saying is that sometimes you have to even stand up to parents and say, I feel like I'm supposed to do this, like go be a missionary to Scotland, and I do promise you I will finish my 2 years. So you have to make a little compromise there with your parents, and also the person you marry and the way you raise your children. So I hear you saying all of these things of ways that can help other people. Well, I appreciate it. By the way, Vicki can come to your church at, she hadn't said she would, but I'm volunteering her, and perhaps you could call her and talk to her about if you have any challenges with how you're raising your children or how your marriage is going, and anything that will help you, she'll be able to counsel with you, I guess.
I'd love to, share, and I'm always open about things that I've struggled with, and Would love to. Would love to be a volunteer.
But along with Ellen and Dr. Nixon and Vicki, I am Bonnie Liphart. Bless your heart for watching. If you'd like to have a copy of this, just let us know. And you see the phone number running across the bottom.